Hello and welcome to Zoom with Czarny. Today is Friday, June 10th, and I'm happy to have my guest today is Tom Keck, a frequent guest on our program, political science director or political science professor up at Syracuse University, expert on the Supreme Court, leader of the CNY Solidarity Coalition. And I had the pleasure of sitting down with him yesterday and watching the January 6th Commission public hearing together, and I thought it was very important to get his perspective. I'm actually covering for a scheduling change that I had. Unfortunately, Bruce McBain was supposed to be on, but that I had a conflict come up, and he's running for the 126th Assembly. He's going to be on later this month, but I also found it kind of important to have Professor Keck on to talk about this important time in our democracy and these important hearings that are going on. So without much further ado, please stick around and enjoy my interview with Professor Keck. And we're back, and I'm so happy to have my good friend, Tom Keck, who is a professor of political science up at the Syracuse University and one of the leaders of the Syracuse CNY Solidarity Coalition, and has been on this program many times. We've mostly talked about Supreme Court. He's a nationwide expert on that. But, you know, last night I had the pleasure of watching the January 6th. Well, it wasn't pleasurable, but we watched the hearing together, and I thought it would be good to have him come on and kind of share his thoughts. Tom, thank you so much for coming on Zoom with Czarny at the last minute here.
Dustin, thanks for having me.
So I guess we'll just start right off with last night's, first public hearing of the January 6th, committee. And what were your takeaways? What's the top line thoughts here? I mean, I thought it was impactful, but what were your thoughts on this?
So I thought it was compelling. I in advance of the first hearing, there's been a lot of sort of speculation or even hand wringing about like how effective is it going to be? Is it going to convince anybody who doesn't already know? You know, the main facts of the insurrection have already been in the public record for some time. But I thought they did a couple things really effectively. One is that there were some new facts revealed and sort of some teasers of some additional new facts to come in the subsequent hearings. So for example, Representative Cheney indicated that Scott Perry and multiple other Republican members of Congress sought preemptive pardons from the Trump White House in the wake of January 6th. So we didn't know that before. There was reporting that there were notable gasps in the room when Chairman Thompson said that after the rioters were chanting "Hang Mike Pence," President Trump said, you know, something like "Good for them." Maybe, you know, Mike Pence deserves it. I don't remember the exact quote. So there was newly seen video footage that nobody had seen before, which was compelling. We've seen lots of video of the days of January 6th. Many of us were watching it live, but you know, there's so many police cameras and security cameras as well as the footage taken by the rioters themselves on their smartphones. And some of that hadn't previously been seen before. So there was in fact some new information. So that's one takeaway. And then I just thought it was a compelling overall story. It was a pretty tight 2 hours of television. The testimony from the Capitol police officer who was injured trying to hold the line was quite gripping. And so I don't know how many people were watching it who don't already know what happened on January 6th, but I do think this hearing, and as a lead-in to the subsequent hearings, has the potential to tell a really compelling story that at a minimum lays down historical record, you know, everything we know that happened on that day and in the events leading up to that day, and it's important for that reason alone.
Yeah, I got to be honest, you know, I've followed this very closely. It's, you know, one of the more important storylines of our generation. And, you know, the moment that we came closest to losing our democracy was January 6th. And I was surprised at some of the video testimony that, and these were just small snippets of video. It was almost like this is the teaser, you know, it was like almost a 2 hour long teaser trailer. You know, when they got into the officer testimony later on in the segment, it got a little bit more detailed, but the first hour before they took that 10 minute break, it seemed like they just kept putting little clippets. You know, first there was the clip of Bill Barr saying that he told Trump three times that the voter fraud, you know, data that is being fed in by these charlatans is not real. There's nothing there. And then there was the, you know, the Ivanka Trump, you know, snippet where she said she believed Bill Barr. And then there was the Jared Kushner snippet of that he thought that the White House counsel was whining when he thought he was going to, resign. But it just led, it told a story, especially that first hour of, you know, that not only was President Trump's words responsible for this, but he knew that his basis for these actions was wrong as well. Is that how you saw it, or?
Yeah, for sure. And bear in mind that the hearings have multiple intended audiences, right? And so these different sort of pieces of the story are important in different ways. So one audience, of course, is the American people, right? We just want, I mean, one audience, as I said already, is the historical record, just to kind of, you know, everything that's in this committee hearing is in the congressional record now, right? I mean, that's for, you know, scholars and historians can pore over that for decades and centuries to come. Another audience is the American people right now, right? Just trying to tell this story in a compelling way. Another audience is the Justice Department, right? I mean, trying to lay out in public all of the evidence that this committee has gathered in a effort to support and encourage the Justice Department's ongoing investigation, right? I mean, Representative Cheney referred last night to the ongoing investigation, which, you know, we haven't seen all of their results yet or something like that. And, you know, some of the language that Representative Cheney used is language that is relevant for potential criminal indictments, right? I mean, the fact that President Trump knew that they have multiple witnesses testifying under oath that they told President Trump the election had not in fact been stolen, he lost it fair and square, right? I mean, that goes to his criminal culpability, right? I mean, that he, and then he inspired the riot anyway, even though he knew he was doing so on a false basis. So yeah, that's, and then an additional audience is members of Congress themselves, right? I mean, so like, for example, is the Senate going to reach a bipartisan agreement on reforming the Electoral Count Act, right? Well, just like kind of laying out as starkly as possible how close we came to a stolen election on January 6th, partly due to the defects of the Electoral Count Act, right, is going to help, you know, provide some additional impetus for those efforts too. So lots going on. And I think you're right that a lot of what we got was just sort of teasers of what's to come, right? Which is important because we want people to keep watching. Right. And so, yeah.
Right. Yeah. I mean, this isn't just, you know, I guess, you know, some people will say that it's, you know, parlor tricks or that, you know, it's political to get people to want to watch this. But, you know, it is important that as many people in our democracy are, you know, aware of what happened that day. And we already had one network decide not to cover it at all, with the Fox News, of course, deciding not to cover it. So, you know, what did you think about what it seemed like they were trying to, and again, every bit of this is like leading into a more expanded hearing that they're going to have later on. And I got to be honest, one of the things that I'm, my ears are like, you know, I'm going to be glued to the TV if I can watch it, given the election and everything, when it happens, the organizations that were organizing on the ground, the Proud Boys and the Oath Keepers, and how interconnected that was, which was, yes, surprising, how they took the tweets and words of Donald Trump, not just in the speech, but in the days and months leading to that speech as directions. And that, I think one of the new things that came out that at least I didn't know is that how these two groups, the Oath Keepers and the Proud Boys, descended upon the Capitol before Trump even started speaking on the Mall. And so it couldn't be seen. It definitely was pre-planned, and organized ahead of time. And they definitely took inspiration from President Trump, if not implicit direction from him.
That's right. And again, some of this we knew previously, but there was new information there, right? I mean, we saw video last night of the leaders of those two organizations meeting with each other, but we couldn't hear the audio, right? It was behind closed doors, but you could see it through the glass video of the leaders on January 5th, the evening of January 5th, the night before the leaders of those two groups were meeting with each other. We heard testimony and we saw the video of several hundred, right, Proud Boys, as you say, marching from the Ellipse to the Capitol before Trump had even started speaking, right? They were not there for a rally at the Ellipse, right? They were there for an organized assault on the Capitol. We know that they were stockpiling weapons across the river in Northern Virginia. In some of the discussions on one of the news networks after the hearings last night, somebody asked Chairman Thompson, is there evidence that Trump or people in Trump's orbit was in contact in advance with the Oath Keepers and Proud Boys? And Chairman Thompson said, yes, that will be in a subsequent hearing, right? So it's there's stuff we already knew. There's more stuff that came out last night, and it sounds like there's still more to come. And it seems so far like very, very clear evidence of a well-planned and organized criminal conspiracy in which Trump played an intimate part.
So, you know, and I do want to touch on the testimony of I forgot her last name, but the female officer that was at the end, because I think that when we talk about new footage and we talk about people being hurt at the Capitol, I did not know that story. I did not know that she was knocked out, that she was how she was knocked out, that and she told a compelling story that it wasn't until certain members of the crowd that were wearing orange hats that were the Proud Boys showed up at that Peace Circle barricade, which she was trying to hold down with a couple of other officers against, you know, 100 or so people. It wasn't until those people arrived that the rhetoric that was being, done by the Oath Keepers leader there started to change and started to be more about antagonistic towards them, almost spurring on the crowd with these antagonizers in the crowd to actually enter the Capitol, to go through the barricades, which by pushing her down, she got knocked out and, suffered, months of recovery. That really was like, wow, it wasn't just, oh, a coincidence that they just happened to be in town. Oh yeah, they showed up early, so what? But it just seemed like there was a plan of attack to stoke the fears of this crowd and get allies to move on the Capitol with that.
That's right. I mean, we knew previously that, that the crowd that day was a mix of organized members of far right extremist groups who were who had tactical gear and planning and communications equipment and alike, a mix of those folks and ordinary Trump supporters who were just there to attend a Trump rally and got kind of riled up in the moment of it. We knew that there was that mix. And we knew from previous testimony, this has come out in some of the criminal prosecutions to date, that there was, you know, sort of intentional efforts by the members of the extremist groups to use the sort of normies, right, the regular Trump supporters there as a human mob, right, to try to rile them up to help overwhelm the Capitol Police. So we already knew that, but the testimony last night had new and additional details about it, right? The testimony from Officer Carolyn Edwards is her name. Officer Edwards said, you know, that the crowd was like milling about and was kind of restless. But then, like, after a couple of the leaders sort of spoke to each other, then one of them started directing very pointed comments towards the Capitol police officers, talking about their pay scales and the like, right? Again, in an effort, talking about how they got paid all throughout COVID. They never missed a paycheck, even though they didn't have to do nothing, right? And like you said, riling up the crowd to, you know, to get a crowd to overrun, violently overrun law enforcement officers, you got to make the crowd angry, right? And the crowd was angry at Mike Pence, the crowd was angry at Speaker Pelosi, and those leaders were making the crowd angry at the Capitol police officers as well, which I did not previously know before last night.
Yeah, that was, I mean, it obviously shows how this happened, and it shows that there was planning ahead of time. You know, this is a point I kind of talked to you about a little bit last night when we were having our discussion during the 10-minute break there. And I kind of, you know, I've been, the more and more I think about this, the more and more I think about the moment that we're in, I feel like we're in this, you know, it's not just Democrat versus Republican. I mean, although the sides are, you know, there, but it's also like a fight against almost a mob mentality, and really even two mobs, right? You have the actual mob that stormed the Capitol, and then the gang that is conspiring behind the scenes to bring this to fruition because they want to keep power. And this seems like everything seems to be deriving from this, you know, this inability to give up any sort of power, even when you know, the voters have spoken, and it's gone beyond, oh, well, we'll get them next election. It's gone to, no, we cannot have that happen at all, ever. There is no retreat, you know, and that we are the divine, you know, we are put in place in a divine way, almost like a monarchical system here, where this is the ruling party and nobody else can be the ruling party, or else everything's rigged and thus violence is allowed to happen because you're standing up for, you know, this divine right to rule almost.
That's right. You can look at it from a couple different dimensions, right? I mean, there's a long history in the history of modern democracy, right? There's lots and lots of examples of conservative parties turning against democracy, right? Sometimes leftist parties do it too, but there's a particular dynamic with conservative parties, because if you think of, you know, every functioning democracy has a conservative party of some sort, which represents the interests of business and capital and landowners and the like. And in a well-functioning democracy, right, where the majority really does get to sort of set the direction for policy, right, regular folks who don't own capital, who don't own a lot of land, who aren't wealthy, are going to be able to vote for fair and redistributive policies that are going to harm the interests of the wealthy, right? And so there's always this kind of tension in democracies where, you know, one major factor that determines the health of democratic systems is whether they have a well-functioning conservative party that is willing to work within the system, as opposed to trying to tear the system down, right? And one of the reasons that many democracies have collapsed historically is because conservative parties have turned against the system, right? So that is a recurring dynamic in the history of democracy, and we're seeing it right now. And if you layer on top of that, the history of US racial politics, right? I mean, we have, you know, we have an increasingly diverse country, and we have white Americans who are scared, right? And don't want to lose their power and status in this increasingly diverse country. And they have, you know, a firmly held belief that America is supposed to be a white people's country, and we shouldn't let other folks take control. So that sort of is an additional motivation for, whether because they're trying to defend, you know, sort of the wealth and power of existing elites, or they're trying to defend kind of white supremacy against a rising a tide of demographic, you know, diversity. They're willing to sacrifice their commitment to democratic norms and institutions, right? If a fairly run democracy is going to lead to new and different kinds of policies and new and different kinds of power dynamics that make certain folks sort of lose what they feel they don't want to lose, right? That then it's, you know, one way to respond to that is say, well, let me make the best democratic case that I can and try to organize my fellow citizens and work within the rules of the game to try to win more elections. That would be one way to respond, but that's not currently how many Republican elites and some Republican voters are responding. They are instead trying to undermine democracy to sort of tilt the rules of the game in their favor.
Yeah. But, you know, we do have to, you know, when we're talking about these conservative and Republican, you know, elites and voters that are not acting appropriately, we should mention the role of Liz Cheney last night, which, you know, look, I do not like Liz Cheney. I'm not a fan. You know, she's voted against voting rights. She's voted against choice. She is not, by any stretch of the imagination, a moderate Republican. She's very conservative. But on this issue, and on the issue of our democracy in general, and I felt her statements last night, and particularly the statement calling out her fellow Republicans about that, you know, Donald Trump will one day be gone, but your cowardice will live on, you know, unless you stop this. I, not even being a fan of her, I was very proud in that moment that she was on that dais. And, you know, how important is it going to be the role of Liz Cheney and, of course, Adam Kinzinger as well, in the coming hearings?
I agree that it's really important, right? I mean, it's obviously many Republicans have been trying to disown Representative Cheney, right? But she clearly is and long has been a conservative Republican. The fact that her last name is Cheney, right, just makes it all the more evocative. Like, a lot of people don't know, a lot of regular people don't know who Representative Kinzinger is, right? But everybody remembers Dick Cheney, right? And so everybody knows, like, oh, Liz Cheney, oh, okay, the vice president's kid, right? And so she has, you know, deep and unquestionable Republican credentials. And so to hear the critiques of Trump and of House Minority Leader Kevin McCarthy, right, and of Scott Perry and the other Republican members who sought preemptive pardons, right? I mean, to hear those coming from Republican Representative Liz Cheney, you know, hits differently, for sure, than to hear them coming from the Democratic members on the committee. And so I don't know how it's going to play out. Right. I don't know how it's going to impact Republican voters. I don't know how it's going to impact other Republican members of Congress. I do think it for sure probably helps with some Republican senators who are currently trying to negotiate reform of the Electoral Count Act. Right. The fact that Liz Cheney is pushing so hard, you know, gives them some support and some cover. And I think it probably helps with the media coverage as well. Right. Just the fact that this is, you know, these criticisms are coming not just from Democrats. It makes it a little bit harder for the media to paint it as a sort of he said, she said, oh, well, Democrats say that Donald Trump stoked an insurrection, you know. Well, no, in fact, a bipartisan House committee is saying that. I just think her testimony, her opening statement, was really compelling. I'm looking forward to more of that from her and from Representative Kinziger as well.
And it should be noted that, you know, the Republicans had every opportunity to have a 9/11 style commission on this. They rejected it. Then the House had an opportunity to have a true bipartisan commission on this. I do believe it's bipartisan now, but Kevin McCarthy, because a few of his people that he put on there were rejected by Nancy Pelosi because they were fact witnesses, and many of those eventually got subpoenaed by this commission. He pulled all of his members, and so Speaker Pelosi had no choice but to continue to go forward with mostly Democratic members and take whoever on the Republican side would join, and that was only Liz Cheney and Adam Kinziger. And so, if they want to complain that this is not a bipartisan exercise, well, you know, it isn't, because they made it that way. You know, and that could be by design as well, to try to lessen the impact of this.
That's right. I mean, it's Republicans, I think, you know, taking orders from Trump, right? Made their decision to not cooperate with any sort of real inquiry into what happened, partly because of orders from Trump, partly because several members of their caucus are significantly exposed, right, to the facts that are going to come out because they participated in the events in question. And yeah, it's just, you can't, you know, so they're going to go on TV and they're going to complain, oh, this is a one-sided commission or whatever. But they're the ones who defeated an even broader bipartisan effort. And so we talked about this a little bit last night, but I do think it's important to sort of bear this in mind. It's, and again, I don't know how it's going to play out, but I think there's a couple sort of favorable dynamics here for just trying to shift the conversation, right? Because on the one hand, it is really important to be hearing the critiques of Trump and the other participants in the insurrection, to be hearing those critiques from a bipartisan group, right? So what we were hearing from Representative Cheney last night is really important for that reason. On the other hand, efforts to pursue bipartisanship, I mean, we've known this for decades now, right? I mean, when one party is kind of intentionally obstructionist, right, then efforts by the other party to pursue bipartisanship create all kinds of barriers to your own agenda, right? So like President Obama being determined to negotiate the Affordable Care Act with Senate Republicans, right, made the law worse, less effective. It made it take a lot longer to enact, and it made it less effective. And the Republicans time and time again have not really been negotiating in good faith. And so if you had a fully bipartisan 9/11 style commission, or if you had a bipartisan House committee where Representative McCarthy had appointed, you know, Jim Jordan or whoever to it, right, that would limit and hamstring so much the ability of those committees to move without fear or favor towards the truth, right? And we don't have that now, right? And it's the Republicans' own fault, right? They left Speaker Pelosi with only one option, which was to move forward on our own. And so we do have a bipartisan committee, but it is also a committee that the Democrats are able to control. So they don't have to tolerate, you know, Jim Jordan, you know, throwing around conspiracy theories about Antifa or whatever it might be. He's not there. And so that allows the committee's efforts to be much more bold and effective. And so we saw that, the importance of that last night. Yeah.
So what do you expect to happen over what are you looking forward to? This is going to go into July. This is not done. This was not the full shot by any stretch of the meeting. You know, even Kinziger took a shot at Elise Stefanik on Twitter saying, I'd hate to be on your end of the insurrection because there's a lot more to come. So what are you looking forward to? What are you going to be watching for over the next few hearings?
Well, so I'm watching for new and additional information that we don't already know for sure. I'm watching for a compelling narrative of what we do know, combining the new information with what we already know, a compelling narrative that will give support to the bipartisan efforts in the Senate to reform the Electoral Count Act, because we're going to see how bad this was that happened last year. We don't want it to happen again. Give support to the Justice Department attorneys who are pushing for indictments of high level folks who participated in these events, possibly including Trump himself. I'm looking for a compelling narrative that appeals to the American people and gets ordinary voters mad about the crime that was perpetrated on the American people. And I'm looking for a compelling narrative that lays down for the historical record. This is what happened, and we're going to do everything we can to make sure this doesn't happen again in the history of American democracy.
Yeah. Well, I want to, before I let you go, I do want to spend a few minutes on Supreme Court, because you're my go-to guy for the Supreme Court. And obviously, we haven't talked since the draft draft Alito opinion on basically overturning Roe v. Wade came out, and that was one of the rulings that you and I talked about before, that we kind of expect something like that is going to happen, maybe not as blatant as what we saw in the draft, but also we're waiting on this New York gun law case, which would restrict the ability of states to restrict guns. And all of this is coming down at a time when, Uvalde and Buffalo and these other things are happening. And I think many of the experts I'm following on Twitter have been very surprised that so many cases are yet to be released. And we're, this June is when they're all going to be released, and we have 30 cases left to go. What do you think's going on? Are they holding these cases till the end on purpose, or are current events keeping them, or blowback from the draft opinion keeping them from releasing these? What do you think's going on here?
Well, we don't know for sure. There's some things we do know, but we don't know for sure what's going on inside the court. So the court almost always saves its most controversial and divisive opinions for the very end, partly because the justices are spending so much time fine-tuning their opinions in those cases, including usually multiple concurring and dissenting opinions, and partly because, frankly, the justices want to issue the controversial decisions at the end and then skip town and not look at the newspapers for a while, and right. And so that part is normal. What is not normal is how much of the court's docket remains undecided, right? So in percentage terms, the portion of their cases that they're going to decide this term where they still haven't released the opinions, it is really high for this late in the term. We also know that at this point in the term, the court almost always issues opinions every Monday morning, and then often on an additional day later in the week. So this week we got opinions on Monday and Wednesday, but last week we got no opinions at all, which is really unusual for this time of year. There was some speculation that, well, what if they had the gun control opinion ready, but then they decided not to release it because of the Uvalde massacre. But we don't know. I mean, that's just speculation. We also know that the leaked opinion in the Mississippi abortion case is an unusual circumstance, and that the justices are sniping at each other. There's been some public reporting of that. We know there's an ongoing investigation trying to get to the bottom of the leak, and there's been some reports that clerks are being asked to turn over their cell phone records, right, which is increasing sort of tension and suspicion in the building. So there's a lot going on. There's just a lot of big cases. There's a lot of less big cases that for some reason they've been slower than usual to process. And then there's been some internal tensions in the institution, right? So yeah. So and in the rest of this month, we're going to get the opinion in the abortion case and the gun case. And there's multiple other big cases still to come too. There's a big environmental regulation case. There's a big church and state case. So it's going to be quite a month for Supreme Court news.
And there were a couple of cases released earlier that I found troubling. the Border Patrol case, where it said that even if we knew that, the Border Patrol case is the one where they basically allow, unrestricted, access within 100 miles of the border, allowing the Border Patrol to, have expanded search and powers. Can you explain what happened there? I mean, that was a 6-3 opinion authored by Thomas, and a lot of advocates are very disturbed by that.
Yeah, I mean, this particular case was mostly about the circumstances under which you're allowed to sue a federal law enforcement officer or any law enforcement officer. And so there's a precedent called Bivens that authorized under certain circumstances such suit, and an unreasonable search has been the most common. That's what Bivens itself was about, and that's the most common circumstance in which that precedent has been used. And the court has been chipping away at that case for years and just making it harder and harder for victims of unreasonable searches to sue the law enforcement officers who engaged in those searches. And they just made it even worse. They did not explicitly overrule the decision in this case, but they've chipped away at it so far that there's barely anything left to it. So there's going to be a lot of it's not a decision that's going to get lots of public attention, but there's just going to be a lot of those kinds of cases, whether it's about voting rights or whether it's about the rights of criminal defendants or whether it's about the ability to file suit to enforce your federal constitutional rights and the like. The court is really retrenching on a lot of fronts all at once.
Well, Tom, thank you so much for taking time at the last minute and joining me today. I'll be looking forward to hearing your thoughts as the Supreme Court ends its session and the hearings are wrapped up for January 6th. We'll talk sometime maybe later this summer, see where we stand with all of this. But anything that I haven't covered that you think is important that should be out there right now that you wanted to make sure that people are thinking about?
Sure. I mean, just real quick. I mean, I don't know when this podcast is going to air, but
hopefully later today. Okay. Amazing. Get it out right now.
Amazing. So the next January 6th hearing is this Monday at 10 a.m. I think it's really important that folks watch them and talk to the friends and family in your life who didn't watch the first one and tell them what you thought of it and encourage them to watch the next one. I just think that's really important. On the gun rights front, there's going to be lots of opportunities for public engagement on that, especially after that court decision comes down. And same with abortion rights, right? I mean, we know that the draft opinion just completely overturns Roe versus Wade. And so if anything similar to that comes out as the final opinion, it's going to be in roughly half the country, it's going to be a very dramatic shift in women's abilities to control their own bodies and their own reproductive lives. And there's no reason that the U.S. Supreme Court should have the last word on these questions, and folks should continue to engage and should be prepared for some long political fights on all of these fronts.
Well, Tom, thank you so much. And thank you for your service to our community and, of course, shaping young minds up at Syracuse University and your devotion to our democracy. It is well needed in this time. And I thank you. I'm glad that you're around. you're a great treasure to our community.
Thanks. Back at you, Dustin. Thank you.
And next week, I will be having Jared Berg on of Vote Early New York on Zoom with Czarny, as we'll be on the eve of the next early voting period. We'll have 3 early voting periods this year because we have 3 elections, but we'll be on the eve of the next early voting period, and we'll be talking about not only early voting, but the legislative session and in its end, and what great voting reforms came out of the session this last year. On my wonky Wednesday I have up right now, Onondaga County, we took a look at that, my annual look at Onondaga County. There's some interesting data in there. And next week I will have a focus on the suburbs of Onondaga County and voter registration. My guest this week was supposed to be Bruce McBain, the assembly. That was a scheduling error on my part. We're going to have him on in a couple weeks as we start getting into the fall elections. So thank you very much and enjoy the rest of your day. Bye-bye.